I make my own cologne. Got my special patchouli blend.
Mark?
I love you like peaches.
Most of us, when we have something to share, tell our stories with words. Whether he's painting, sculpting, or songwriting, Bob Schneider uses his art. He has a lot to say about this life and everything in it. He's never afraid to say what he thinks when the spotlight shines his way, which is pretty much always. For three decades, Bob Schneider has consistently packed the house in Austin's major music venues. His roadshow draws a crowd anywhere it goes. People show up for more than the music. They want to hear what this guy has to say. It's always hilarious, poignant, and never the same. Bob Schneider's our studio guest this week on Songwriters Across Texas.
Music's something I always have done. My dad's a musician, and he played music his whole life, and he played on TV shows, like on variety shows back in the 50s and stuff, and so it's something he did his whole life. And then when I was a kid, he taught me how to play guitar, and me and my sister both, and so we would, you know, we started entertaining their guests probably at 4 or 5 years of age.
Yeah, I got a lot of Bobby stories. A lot of Bobby stories. We had a great big party at our house. He was about 3 or 4, maybe 5. And we had one of those parties, you know, everybody parties till they drop. So everybody dropped. A fat tenor friend of mine was sitting in a chair like this. And the next day, here's this little sketch of this fat tenor friend of ours. We knew exactly who the guy was, this fat tenor friend. So everybody's getting up, you know, hungover. And I didn't do it. I don't know. Bobby gets up. Did anybody see my drawing? And I said, you do it?
I feel like that was the only time I felt like totally safe. Drawing was a world that I was in control of. I was the master of everything. I could draw whatever I wanted, do whatever I wanted in this little imaginary world. And so art and the stage were both safe. And then everything else was scary as shit. You know, when you're 4 and you play a song, people go nuts. Like, they go crazy. And so it instills this sort of sense that you're really good, like at a cellular level. And so I've just always had this idea that I'm really good at this, even though I'm not really that good at it, and I never have been. Because I have this idea that I'm good at it, I've just kept at it.
Thanks a lot, welcome to the Saxon Pope. We're lonely, Lance, nice to be here.
Ever showed his face, he came calling at my place. He had long a beautiful hat upon his head. I asked him why. He just turned to me and he said, there is love. Everything I see, there is love inside of you and me. There is love.
All the support's always come from my audience. Like, I've been able to find audiences who like what I do and have supported me. And so I love making things, and I love, you know, whatever it is, if it's a song or art or performing. I could not do any of those three.
I just love it. I moved out here like 18 years ago. I've been out here ever since. First, maybe it was a little far out, but now it doesn't, I don't know if it's far enough out actually, but when I bought the place, there was a horse and what I believed was a goat. They took the horse and they left the goat. And then I called a goat rescue place and they came over and they're like, that's not a goat, it's a sheep. But they took the sheep and that was it. We actually separated about 16 years ago, me and my ex-wife, and then it took about 3 or 4 years to get, we slow rolled the divorce. There was no real hurry. And it was tough going through the divorce. It was probably the low point for me. But since that time, my ex-wife has married a wonderful guy who I really like and admire. And I'm remarried which is great. And so I love this life. It's like a divorce song, but it's just a different perspective. The songs I was writing 10 years ago about divorce were really sad, and they were about loss and about how hard that is. And this divorce song is like, eh, you know, what are things?
You can have the money, take the house and the car, take everything I've ever made so far, take it away so I won't see it again. Leave me here a broken man, that's okay, 'cause everything you think you'll own's a lie, and everything you think you know's just some lullaby somebody wrote long time ago. Nobody knows nothing I know. I love this life and everything in it. I love this love and I just wanna give it. I love this life and everything, and it fills me with love, and I just wanna give it to you. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And sometimes when the world gets too hard to bear, I might say I really don't care. I might try and act cool to keep from falling apart, try to build a wall around my heart, but I must confess that I don't wanna be that way. All I wanna do is just run through the day and smile at everybody I see. Smile at everybody, have them smile back at me. I love this life and everything in it. Ooh, I love this love and I just wanna give it. I love this life and everything, and it fills me with love, and I just wanna give it to you. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And if the robots come and take over with their wicked way, I reminisce the way the old folks do about these good old days. I love this life and everything in it. I love this love and I just want to give it. I love this life and everything, and it fills me with love, and I just want to give it to you. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Every time I write a song, I'm like, ah, oh, this should be so much better. But again, that hasn't stopped me from writing. It's just been confounding because I guess I'm insane. I'm only saying that because the evidence points at insanity.
This is a pretty good one right here.
I don't feel insane, but that's insane. People don't feel insane. You know, that's the problem with insane people. They think they're not.
You know, like when you take the skin off a carrot, like when you're peeling potatoes and it's just like perfect, it just gives you that satisfying feeling. It's very similar to that. It is weird because, you know, obviously on their own, they look very phallic, but then when you put them in groups, like these two guys together, you know, is that the mom and dad? And then, you know, what is this guy? You know, you just start putting them together, and then all of a sudden they start creating these relationships. And then you, as a human being, you're going to make a story. Like if you come across that, you're gonna be, what is that? And then if you don't have the answer, you're gonna make up an answer. And songwriting is the same thing, where like my favorite songs are ones where I say a little bit, but then I leave a lot of stuff that you can fill in with your own, experiences.
I want to dedicate this song to anybody here that's in a long-term relationship. Ooh, yeah. How about that response? Just nothing but silence, sadness, and resignation. It's not fun. It's not easy at all. It's a lot of work. Anyways, I do think it's something remarkable if you can make a relationship work over a long period of time. And
there's a part in a relationship that's kind of drug-like, where you're like euphoric. At a certain point, I think the reason a lot of relationships fail is that somebody in the relationship's not happy, and they're like, well, it's not my kids, it's not my job, it's not me, it's gotta be this person I'm in a relationship with. and then they bail on the relationship, only to look for somebody just like that again and repeat the same thing over and over again, unless at some point they kind of figure it out and go, oh yeah, I can't look to this person or to my kids or to my job or to anything really to make me happy. It's an inside thing that has nothing to do with any of those things.
Well, I can't be your American Jesus, and I can't be your exciting career, and I know you never asked me for either, but I know somehow I've let you down, my dear. And I know well the sound of your laughter. I've made a map of all your fears, and I'll take you home when this party's over. I'll still take you home after all these years. And I'll lie beside you while you lie there sleeping, while the wolves pile up outside on the lawn. When the stars seek you out so far from heaven, I'll still be here for you long after they're gone. I know well your need for solace, what hides under the embers of all your tears, and I'll take you home when this party's over. I'll still take you home after all these years. Both time and love aren't set in stone, only borrowed or freely given, and they're both so heavy they can break your heart. And I can't be the thing that makes you happy. Maybe once I was, but not anymore. I can only be who I am, waiting here for you when you come through the door. I know well the tides of your affection, the way they wax and wane. And I'll take you home when this party's over. I will always take you back home.
Thank you.
I've always had this idea that, like, somehow success or money or something would sort of fix whatever the problem is. And you could be loved, like Anthony Bourdain and Robin Williams, both of those guys, you know, had families, you know, who loved them. And something about those guys dying made me realize, oh no, there's no, it doesn't matter. You could be a billionaire. You could have all the success in the world. You know, it's only a big deal if somebody loves you, if you die. There's people that die all the time that nobody loves and nobody cares about, and it's not a big deal. And so I mentioned him, like, in the third line of the song. I don't know. It has a lot to do with that book, obviously, Lord of the Flies, which is this idea that, you know, we're animals, you know, and you leave us up to our own devices without the constraints of society and rules and ethics and the police and the government. Who knows what we'll do? I mean, like, you see it all the time where, you know, people do just terrible, horrible, crazy things. So it's all very bizarre to me. Like, all of it is very bizarre. And I think that song kind of encapsulates a lot of my bewilderment about just being a human being.
I'm in the Space Force now, I'm on my way back home. I got my cell phone on, so I'm never alone. I heard he hung himself from the bathroom wall. Yeah, I'm in the Space Force and I'm having a ball. I'm in the Space Force now, I got a brand new hat. He used to hold me down just like that. But the flames rose up and took you away. I'm in the Space Force, it's all okay. They come as no surprise. They come as no surprise. I'm in the Space Force now, did you get my card? I wrote it to you from the bottom of my heart. Yeah, I swore I'd always be a friend to you. I'm in the Space Force, so you know it's true. May come as no surprise when you peel away the lie. It may come as no surprise. Space Force now here in Vietnam. You can really stretch a dollar, this place is the bomb. You can do what you want, I mean you really can. Nothing's off limits in this beautiful land. I'm in the Space Force now, I'd say okay.
We take in a lot of information, and it gets distilled into whatever we do. I mean, I've written so many songs, but if I start to write a song right now, I'm basically back where I was when I started writing songs when I was a teenager. I'm at ground zero. It's not like woodworking where you get to be a master carpenter and you know how to build something. That's not how songwriting works. I mean, you can get really good at playing your instrument, but when it comes to actually creating or coming up with an idea for a song, you're always starting from scratch. And it's scary to like, because you're looking into the unknown inside of yourself, and you gotta face that. But I've done, the only thing that's changed is I've done that so many times, I'm not afraid of it. And I just do it. And then I'm always shocked by what comes out of it. Like, I'll just do it, and then, oh, there's a song, there's a poem, there's a piece of art. And it always happens. But it comes out of all that massive amount of information that we take in. And then it seems mysterious, because it comes out in such a strange, marvelous way sometimes, if you're lucky. And then that collage turned into thousands of pieces of stuff in there, and then painting. And then I went from that to doing this really simple stuff, just like a figure with a background and maybe some confetti. What ends up happening with the art is I'll do it if I love doing it. And then if I love doing it, I'll do it kind of to death. And then I'll get tired of it, and then I'll stop doing it, and I won't ever do it again. The worst thing I can do when I'm writing a song or doing anything when it comes to art is try to make something great. As soon as I start wanting to make something great, I introduce the critic. I invite the critic into the room, and all the critic is doing is telling me, oh, that's stupid, that's not cool, that's not great, that sucks. So I'm like, hey, critic, get out. I'm gonna do this, and when I'm done, then we can look at it together and see if it's worth putting on an album or performing or whatever. Really, all I'm trying to do is have fun, because there's that creative part in your brain that just wants to have fun. It's like a little kid that wants to dance around in its underwear and just dance and have fun and not worry about what anybody thinks about it. And when you can access that, it's awesome and it's fun.
I feel like the best songs are songs that you write about something that happened a long time ago. So right before I got sober, I was in a band that was doing pretty good. We were signed. We went to California to make our big major label, you know, recording. I was, you know, looking good, but I was so just unhappy. You know, mainly because of this drinking. I was drinking, this constantly losing relationships because of it, putting myself in danger, putting people that I love in, you know, harm's way or whatever. And at the time, I just remember thinking, well, if things stay this bad, I can always kill myself. And so that idea, that sort of romantic idea of killing myself was just a part of my life. You know, when you're younger, as hopeless as you are, you still, you know, you're looking good and you got your life ahead of you. I don't know, as I've gotten older, I've been able to experience my feelings, both the sublimely beautiful feelings that I get, where I can like just be here and look at a tree and I can start crying, but then I can also feel despondent in a way that I think you have to live 50 years to feel that despondent and that hopeless. At this point, you're like, well, a lot of it's behind me now. All of this stuff just comes out of the blue. It comes out of my subconscious. And I realize, oh yeah, has a lot to do with these feelings that I've had my whole life, but, you know, lately more as I've gotten older, but also very reminiscent of that time right before I quit drinking as well, so. The thing that I think that's important to remember about that song is that the narrator's talking about killing themselves, and they're not actually killing themselves. So I think that's an important distinction. I'm not saying that, you know, go kill yourself or anything like that. I'm hoping that people will listen to the song and they'll go, oh, I sometimes think that too. And maybe they won't feel so alone.
I'm going down to Lake Michigan. I'm gonna throw myself into the sea. I'm going down Lake Michigan, That's the last you gonna see of me. I ain't got nobody. Ain't nobody got me. I ain't got nobody. Guess that's the way the Lord wanted it to be. And if you wanna tell me some story.
If I don't create the feeling, and I know it's not real, but the feeling that I have is that I'm going to die. I'm gonna be like, I'm like this little baby wrapped up in like a little swaddle by a gutter, and the rain's coming down, and it's at night, and I'm gonna die there by being sucked into the drain, whatever it is. That's the feeling if I don't create something. Because that's the only way that I have any chance to be okay. I don't need to write any more songs. I've written enough songs to make 10 more albums, 10 more pretty, probably good albums. But if I don't make stuff, I feel like I'm gonna die. So I have to keep doing it.
Yeah, don't baby, when you find me, don't put my body in the box. Leave me in the water, down among the rocks. 'Cause I'm going down to Lake Michigan. I'm gonna throw my in the sea.